Well, hey, Harvest. We wanted to invite you in to hear some of the things that have been our hearts as some of your pastors, because of all that's going around in our country. There's a lot of unrest. There's a lot of anger. There's a lot of tension. And every week, you know, we bring to you God's word, and we trust that the message that he has for our church is always there. And we're thankful for that, but we also want to share our heart at times on just things that are going on, things that are going on around us. And just to start, I want to say that what we're doing here today is, first, we're not bringing to you this agenda. We're not bringing to you this list of, here's everything you need to feel, here's everything you need to think, and then here's everything you need to do. If agendas were going to take us to the place we wanted to get to, then I think we probably would have already gotten there. And instead, what we want to do today is just show you a bit of relationship, because if change is going to happen, it's going to happen in relationship.
Yeah.
And I'm thankful that here next to me, I have two brothers, and God doesn't have many families. He has one family. And so because God is our father, these are my brothers, and we all come from very, very different places. You know, I grew up in Mexico. I'm Mexican-American. And, you know, I'll let them kind of speak to their backgrounds too, but we're different, and God made us different. And so we're going to have different perspectives, but we today just want to let you hear our hearts, and maybe I'll just share what's on my heart first, and then I'll hand it to you guys. But I, one of the red flags that went up for me with all that's been going on in our country, and as I've witnessed videos, you know, like last week and seeing George Floyd's video, the red flag that came on my heart was realizing that I naturally had a bent towards being analytical, and I was jumping right away past feeling and seeing what I was seeing to deciding what I thought about it, and deciding how I was going to have an opinion about it, and how I was going to argue with my friends about it. And that really grieved my heart, because out of all the things that I've been learning, even as I've been preaching through the series that we've been doing here through the book of Mark, you guys know that before God lets you be a teacher, he makes you a student, right? And and you know, a few weeks ago I preached on justice and mercy, and how in the kingdom of God you have to be able to see both those things. And if my opinion, if me trying to figure out what's going on is so important to me that I skip the mercy part, something's wrong.
Yeah.
And I just think the lesson I'm pulling out of this is I have to start with compassion. I have to start with seeing what is happening in our country and acknowledging that any loss of life, any loss of innocent life, should grieve my heart, because every man and woman bears the image of God himself. This is how he made the world. And if it grieves his heart, why isn't it grieving my heart? Well, it's not because I don't think about it. It's because I'm trying to skip it and jump to the next thing.
Wow.
And I just don't want to be that way. And I don't want us to be that way. I want us to be able to see what's happening and allow our hearts to be grieved by the fact that there is loss, and we have lost people who God made in his image. And things ought not be this way. And so that's really what's been on my mind just this past week. And like I said, we don't have all the answers, and we're not trying to fix everything here, but we can have a conversation here with each other as brothers. So Tommy, I was kind of curious, like, what's been going on with you?
Yeah, so I felt heartache, you know, watching the video, and disgust. Yeah, I'm a little less analytical, a little bit more emotional. I don't display it a ton, but I'm an emotional person. And so my emotions immediately ran to anger, deep sadness, disgust watching that video. And trying to work through that. What is that, you know, what do I do with this emotion? And, you know, I think as a white man from rural Wisconsin, you know, I lived, you know, kitty corner to a cow farm in a cornfield.
Yeah.
And I went to school with people, 99% of them, who looked exactly like me. And so feeling that sense of a little bit of inadequacy, I didn't really start learning about these issues and this, you know, specific, you know, situation for our brothers and sisters until college. And so it's been a learning experience up until then. And I think the Lord has really pressed on my heart in this season of prayer is the thing in my spiritual table when things get busy or crazy that I tend to push off first. And the Lord's been pressing on my heart to fervently pray. And not just to do that, but to act. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And in that fervent prayer, I've been praying the Lord's Prayer, which is a very good prayer to pray, you know? And thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth right. as it is in heaven.
Yeah, that's good, Tommy.
And in heaven, there is no racial injustice. In heaven, there is no racial disparity or racial discrimination. All are equal mm-hmm. before the Lord our God. And so in this season, I want to stand and support and love our brothers and sisters of color until that statement is true on earth as it is in heaven. Yeah. What about you, Ed? How have you been feeling through all of this?
I tell you, it's been really challenging. I think there have been days where I've been encouraged as I see the peaceful protest and I see Black, white, Latino, Asian, international, even outside of our country, people grappling with this tragedy. And then there's been days where I've really grappled with righteous anger.
Yeah.
What is it like to be in a country that continues to grapple and be stunted by this issue of racism? And I found myself finding that protest and prayer, they're actually two sides of the same coin. It's something that happens when you passionately cry out to the Lord when you don't know what to do. And then you get up off your knees and then you put into action what the scriptures actually say. And so for me, I feel like America has always had a racism problem, but we have a greater in the church. We have a theology problem. Mm-hmm. We don't understand that Genesis 2 and 3 says that we're created in the image of God.
Right.
So when I see you as a biracial Mexican American, and I see you as my white brother, I see others, I see myself. I see the image of God.
Right.
And Matthew 18 has been ringing in my heart. Jesus in the parables shares about the one sheep that got away. And I didn't see the shepherd yell, "Hey, all sheeps matter." You know, that would be foolishness. They all do matter, those sheep do matter. But he left and he went after that one.
Yeah.
I feel like we all are going after that one whose life was snuffed out and trying to keep people's focus on. This is a hard journey. And the journey that I've been on for over 30 years, it's been hard because mm-hmm. I'm called into places where I am not the majority. And there's a price for what I say and how I say it and where I say it. And so being able to be in safety of you two and Pastor Dave Sohn, as we've been just wrestling, grappling with Mark, and it's been mm-hmm. really a blessing and a challenge.
Yeah. And I know, you know, everyone listening is probably thinking, like, what can we do? And this is an important point because I see it all the time. We, in our hearts, we feel the burden, and then we feel like, well, we got to do everything to fix this. And then we get overwhelmed because we're like, well, we can't fix it. We can't do everything, but we got to do something. And let's not let the everything get in the way of doing something. And so, maybe, you know, what are some of the things we can do over the next few months to at least take steps forward?
Sure. I think as a church, we feel a responsibility to help people biblically look at this issue as well as grapple in their hearts. And so there's really three things over the next 90 days that we're going to be leading and serving our church in. One, we're going to learn more about what the Bible has to say about lamenting. Mm-hmm. Nehemiah and Jeremiah are just great examples of this. They didn't hurry and move into action, but they just sat with identifying with the reality of the pain. And I think that there's something that we all can do, regardless of race, in learning to lament. Mm-hmm. Second thing is we're learning to listen for understanding, not just to be heard. A few weeks ago, I said, listen.
Yeah.
And then when you're ready to respond, pause and listen some more.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So we're going to practice that. But the third thing is we're going to learn together. We're going to choose three books. There are many others, but we're going to choose three books, have a little Harvest Book Club once a month, June, July, and August. And we're just going to read together and have some online discussion as we're growing together. And so we want to really take our activism and our anger and our joy. We want to put it into action. We have a long way to go. We've learned a lot as a church, but we have a long way to go. Yeah. And so we're not in a hurry, but we're going to learn and we're going to listen and we're going to lament together. And I know, Tommy, you've been working on some things just personally too.
Yeah. And I mean, you've been a phenomenal help to me in processing and getting these conversations started. And one of the things I was just reading in the book of Philippians, it's in chapter 4 at the end, Paul says to the Philippian church, "It was kind of you to share in my trouble." And so Paul was facing persecution, injustice in the place that he was sharing the gospel. And of course, that's not a one-to-one. It's different, right? But the principle remains the same. And he said to the Philippians, "It was kind of you to share in my trouble." And so I think, and he goes on and talks about the partnership that he has with this group of people and how that's encouraging to him. And I think, you know, in this moment, taking that position of the Philippian church and being kind to our brothers and sisters and sharing in their trouble. We're not experiencing the same trouble, but we can share in it. And really practically, by the ways that you just said, by lamenting, by listening, and by learning. And I've started to have great conversations with brothers and sisters and listening, really listening, how they're feeling, what they're thinking, how this affects them. And that has led to, over a course of even just a couple of conversations, learning. And I feel like I've learned more in the past couple of weeks than I have over decades of my life. And it's been really helpful to me because now I'm learning about the struggle and the trouble of my brothers and sisters in Christ who don't exactly look like me and have been experiencing this deep pain for so long. And so I love that we're doing this as a church together, lamenting and listening and learning. I think it's going to be super beneficial.
Well, and I think it's just so important to see how when you're, even as you're sharing about listening, like I can sense that it requires a humility. And we know, God took the time to explain to us that if he's gonna show up in grace and pour out his blessing, it's on those who are humbling themselves. Yeah. Instead of the ones who have it all together and have their, you know, lists to check and all that. No. It's humility. It's choosing that lower position before God and others. And then letting the actions flow from that. So that's what I want for our family, and that's what I'm thankful that I get to share with you guys as my brothers.
Yeah, thanks.